Hello world, Dr. Doherty from ACU here to talk about oscillations and simple harmonic motion. So imagine I've got some object that's oscillating back and forth or side to side forever. If I make a graph of its displacement versus time, I've got its equilibrium resting position at x equals 0, but it's not sitting there, it's oscillating from some positive end to some negative end, back and forth for all time. Let's define some vocabulary words that we're going to need for this unit. So the maximum displacement is called the amplitude. If this is my x equals 0, the amplitude is how far out do I swing in the positive or negative directions. Notice the amplitude isn't the maximum positive to the maximum negative. That's twice the amplitude. Amplitude is from the x equals 0 resting point to one end or the other. The second thing is the frequency. Now the units we use for frequency are hertz, Hz, that's units of per second. So if I do one complete cycle per second, that's 1 hertz. If I do 2 cycles per second, it's 2 hertz, and so on and so forth. The only tricky part is, make sure you're counting cycles correctly. Now a cycle here means one complete path of the motion. If I start here at my positive extreme, I go to the negative extreme and come back. That's 1 cycle. Or if I start in the middle, I go to the positive end, then the negative end, and then come back. That's 1 cycle. Don't accidentally get half of that. Now the time for one oscillation is the period. We're going to use a capital T for that, and that's measured in seconds. So if it takes you 2 seconds to do one oscillation, your period is 2 seconds, but your frequency is 0.5 seconds. All right, so we have some formulas here. The frequency is 1 over the period. I'm also going to define an angular frequency, an omega. That's just the frequency times 2 pi. Now we're going to use this to connect back to the rotation unit that we did before. So if I want to find out my motion in terms of displacement, velocity, and acceleration, one way to think about this is imagine I have some kind of mass sitting on some turntable, and my turntable is spinning at some angular velocity omega, just like we talked about in the last unit. It's turned a total of theta, which is omega t radians in t seconds, and then I could figure out the x component of where it is for displacement, velocity, and acceleration. And when you do that, you get a not too horrible result. So the displacement is the amplitude times the cosine of omega t. Now if you're friendly with calculus, all I gotta do is take the derivative to get velocity and the derivative of that to get acceleration. Nice and fast and easy. If you're not, you can still derive all these equations by thinking about x components of the tangential velocity and acceleration. You get the same result. So let's think about what this means. We've got to be really clear about a couple of things. So again, here's my path. I started up here, I oscillated, and I'm now at some point P. Let's think about my velocity. When I'm at the extreme, if I imagine someone, say, on a swing set or a pendulum going back and forth, I am going up and I'm going to stop and turn around and come back down. So up here at the very extreme, my velocity is going to be 0. Now here I'm going from my positive extreme towards my negative extreme. So my velocity is going to be negative the whole way, from here to here. And as I go from my extreme to the midpoint, I speed up. Again, think of someone on a swing set. You're going the fastest at the bottom of the swing. And that has to be true from conservation of energy, right? All your potential is in kinetic now. So then I'm going to be going downwards but speeding up. Here I'm still going downwards but slowing down until I turn around and stop and then start going in the positive direction. Maximum velocity, stopped, negative, speeding up. So this is the pattern that our velocity always takes. The acceleration is a little bit different. So if I go back to the swing set, the further you are away from the equilibrium point, the more force and the more acceleration there's going to be. So your maximum acceleration is at the maximum. So I'm going to have a lot of force wanting to pull me back towards the equilibrium. As I get closer to my equilibrium point, my acceleration gets smaller and smaller until it's zero at x equals zero. If I'm on a swing set and I'm just dangling at the resting point, right beneath the support, I have no force, no acceleration. Then I'm going to be moving downward still, so my acceleration now flips and points me back towards the middle, maximum acceleration at my maximum displacement. And I go back towards the middle, my acceleration is zero, and then I keep going this way, so my acceleration flips and always points down. The acceleration always points inward. This kind of motion requires a restoring force that always points you towards equilibrium, so acceleration always points that way. Now it's time to make a physical model that can do this. One way is to think about a mass on a spring. I'm going to be ignoring gravity for a little while and friction and drag. I've just got some object on a spring. I pull it and let it go until it oscillates back and forth forever. Now the first thing is the force. A nice equation called Hooke's law tells us the force that a spring applies on an object. So the amount of force, this F here, is equal to some constant K called the spring constant. That's a measure of how stiff or floppy a spring is. A large K means a stronger spring, and a small K means a weaker spring, times X. Now remember, it's a very important definition. X is the amount of stretch, not the total length of the spring. So if my spring has a natural resting point here along this line, X is not the distance of the spring. X is the distance from its natural resting point to where it is now. I have stretched it some distance x over where it wants to be. This minus sign in Hooke's law says the force always points in the opposite direction of x. So if I pull it to the right, the force points back to the left. It's a restoring force, always pointing me back towards equilibrium. So now I'm going to combine these equations that we've written down. I'm going to say f equals ma, and for Hooke's law, this f is negative kx. I'm then going to throw in the equations on the previous slides for x and a. So I do that, and my cosine omega t cancels out. My minus signs are going to cancel out. My a is going to cancel out, and I can solve for omega. And I get a simple equation that says my angular frequency is the square root of k over m. So you give me a spring and a mass, I can tell you its frequency or its period of oscillation. All right, so now let's think about energy. I can also store energy in a spring, and like with kinetic energy or gravitational potential energy, energy is always better to think about than force. The formula is pretty easy, 1/2 kx squared. That should remind you of kinetic energy, 1/2 mv squared. This still has units of joules. It's the energy stored in a spring that's stretched or compressed by length x. Because x is squared, it doesn't matter if it was stretched or compressed. It could be positive or negative. The square kills that minus sign. So if I stretch it by some extra distance x, I've added that much potential energy to my system. So you should be able to have problems where you start with a stretched spring, and you launch a ball in the air or up a ramp. You turn that potential into kinetic, conserve energy, just like you always have before. One closely related system to an oscillating spring is a pendulum. So again, think about a swing set. It turns out that there is no simple equation that describes the motion of a pendulum. It seems like we should have a harder problem before math absolutely can't solve it, right? But here we are. We can, however, make some simplifying assumptions, and we can get some simple equations from that. So, if I have some kind of object on some kind of rod or string, if I assume that absolutely all of the mass is here at the end, if I assume then that this rod is completely rigid and massless, and if I assume that the angle is really, really small, so only a few degrees, then I can write some fairly simple equations. If I break those assumptions, then I can deal with some more complex equations, or the thing becomes completely unsolvable. Okay, so what happens? If I were to think about gravity and I were to write down the torque and I were to kind of use my imagination and squint, I could come up with an equation that looks a lot like the spring equation. And when I do that, I can find that its frequency, omega, is only the square root of g over L. This should look very similar to that equation for the spring. Omega is the root k over m. It's the exact same idea. Now, one thing that's cool about this is it does not depend on mass or on theta. That's what makes pendulums really great for keeping time. The mass doesn't have to be precise. The angle doesn't have to be precise. They're going to oscillate at some frequency based on their length alone. Now, using that omega is 2 pi f, or 2 pi over t, I can find the period for one oscillation just by doing a little bit of algebra, so we can calculate how long it would take. This is the equation you'd use to build a clock or to measure gravity on some planet. Now, the last idea on this video. If I have an object, it's obviously not going to oscillate back and forth forever and ever. That doesn't happen. The motion is always going to be damped in some way. So it's going to slow down and eventually grind to a halt. So if I see what actually happens, this model we've been talking about of simple harmonic motion is this red curve here, where something oscillates forever and ever at the same amplitude and the same frequency. Now, there are three kinds of damping that you need to know. The first is underdamped. So the yellow and green curves gives us two different examples of underdamping. So let's look at the green curve. In my first oscillation, I lose some amplitude, then I lose some more, and my amplitude gets that smaller and smaller and smaller. My frequency also starts to slow down. It takes me longer and longer to do an oscillation to get back to equilibrium. The yellow's even a more dramatic case, where my amplitude goes away more quickly and my frequency changes more quickly. Now, suppose I get the perfect amount of damping, so I just grind to a halt right away. That's called a critically damped system. So I let go, it goes to equilibrium and stops. That's the best you can possibly do. I can do worse than that. If I have too much damping, I get an overdamped situation where there's so much resistance it takes me too long to get back to my resting point. So the three types are underdamped, critically damped, and overdamped. Now, there are equations you can use to find out these things, but we're going to move on to our last idea before we get bogged down in those details. Now, let's suppose we add a driving force to our system. So I'm going to not only let it oscillate on a spring or a pendulum under gravity, but I'm also going to give it a push. This is called now driven harmonic motion. Now, by far, the most interesting case is called resonance, where the system is driven at its natural frequency. So let's think about this. Every real object or structure has some frequency where it'll oscillate. Give it a push or a thump, and it will start to wobble a little bit. So if I imagine picking up this wine glass and flicking it with my finger, it'll make some kind of ping because it's going to oscillate at some frequency. Now, if I then give it a force at exactly that frequency, all those pushes are going to add up together on top of each other. Those amplitudes are going to get really, really big and really, really crazy until something interesting happens, usually something getting destroyed. Resonance is a fascinating thing that has lots of really neat applications. So that's it for today. The big ideas we've talked about, this thing called simple harmonic motion. That's just a repeated oscillation. Imagine sine waves, springs, pendulums, that kind of thing. Know the definitions of amplitude, frequency, and period, and know how to calculate them if you know a couple of them. We then talked about springs. So we've got Hooke's law, F is negative kx. We've got elastic potential energy, 1/2 kx squared. And if I have a spring with spring constant k and mass m, it's going to oscillate this way. My spring equation, omega is root k over m. We talked about simple pendulums, where the omega is root g over l, so I could then calculate frequencies and periods given a pendulum. Last thing, we talked about the three kinds of damping: underdamped, critically damped, overdamped, and then the driven case where I give a force where you need to know what resonance is. Those are the big ideas. Next video, something completely different. Thanks for watching.